The following video contains spoilers for the entire Danganronpa franchise. Weeb discretion is advised. Danganronpa is usually on Steam sale, so pick it up and sink your life into one of the greatest endings of all time. Danganronpa V3 Killing Harmony has one of the most profound endings in any story ever, and I'm going to tell you why. Despite being a polarizing ending to a fantastic series of games, I feel it's important to understand why the ending matters so much, not only as a product of its time, but a perfect representation of the subversion of expectations and individual freedom. I recently drove 7 hours through Middle America to visit family, and on my return journey, I had exhausted my music playlists in about 3 hours. There was no better time to listen to Danganronpa V3 Chapter 6 Final Class Trial Playthrough English Dub, posted 4 years ago from Just One Gamer. About 2 years prior, I had finished playing through the third main series installment of the Danganronpa franchise, and the way I played through was a bit unorthodox. I had bought all three games at once when they were on Steam sale, and played through the first two games, Danganronpa Trigger Happy Havoc and Danganronpa 2 Goodbye Despair, in relative succession. To say I enjoyed the experience would be an understatement. That was an easy 30 hours of my life just dedicated to surviving two killing games. So, I readily started up V3 and quickly realized it would be a little longer than the other two games. So much so that I played through the first trial and was like, whoa. Then, due to school and work commitments, I took a hiatus for a few months before finishing playing it. Part of the reason I thought I needed a break was because it just seemed like too much of a task to take on. For those unacquainted, Danganronpa takes heavy inspiration from Koshun Takami's 1999 novel, Battle Royale, a story about a killing game taking place in an alternate reality in which Japan and the Axis powers won World War II, and the government maintains authority, not in small part, due to the Battle Experiment No. 81 program. This endeavor selects 50 random students from their third year of junior high and drops them into the isolated Okishima Island, forcing them to kill each other if they want to escape. If you ever get a chance to read or listen to the unabridged version of the novel, I would highly recommend it, because you can tell how much more well thought out and historically relevant this Chad Battle Royale was compared to the Virgin Hunger Games. And Danganronpa, in its myriad of references, fourth wall breaks, and the whole shebang, pays homage to the themes of that narrative, especially in V3, but we'll talk about that a little later. The first game was relatively simple. It was a story of students trapped in a school and forced to kill each other, given different incentives compelling them towards doing so. Situations that further and further drove them into depravity while relying heavily on the psychopop genre of aesthetically pleasing anime waifus gargling spouts of pink blood. The catch of Danganronpa is that if you kill someone to escape, a class trial rail shooter section ensues where you bring forth evidence and expose the culprit, subsequently brutally executing them in front of the rest of the survivors. Slowly but surely, the class is whittled down just to a few remaining students. The second game expanded on the simplistic design of the first and went full blast with the anime influence, including crazy specialized ultimates, magical girls, mechas, life being a simulation, and a minigame that was actually relevant to the plot. And this is not even mentioning the UI and gameplay upgrades that were made since the first game. Quick side note, I would like to mention that ports to the PC unfortunately had errors for every single game. Goodbye Despair asked the question of whether or not you truly know who you are. Are you the villain? And what does reality represent? Very early in the game, Usami demonstrates explicit magic, letting you know things aren't all what they're cracked up to be. And the more you delve into Jabberwock Island, the more suspicious you'll become of this situation, resulting in the culmination of what Danganronpa means on an emotional level. Danganronpa V3 is different. The thematic elements of the second game's climax are condensed and sped up through the first trial of the third game. The parallels between Hinata's journey mirror Kaede's, all within the first few hours. But what's great about Kaede is that she has considerably more personality than Hinata in much more limited time. And Hinata is what I would argue is one of the weaker aspects of the second game. Though I might have to mention I'm a little biased because I am something of a pianist myself. The best way I can put it is that the first game had the most solid story, the second game had the most solid trials, and the third game had the most solid characters. This comes from the fact that V3 is longer than the first two games combined. Characters are given time to be fleshed out, significantly better than in previous installments. This is not to say the characters are the deepest in all of fiction, however, they are advanced beyond stereotypes to be somewhat of believable caricatures of what high school students actually might be like. This is exemplified through free time and support conversations, which allow you to gain different power-ups for the trials based on which character you spend time with. This has been a consistent gameplay element since the original game. Through these conversations, you gain a new perspective on how every character reacts to the situation they are in. And I honestly couldn't care what a character looks like, how he or she identifies, or what he or she believes if they're a well-written character. That's why, while I can disagree with certain characters' motivations, it may still be possible to empathize with them. While every single character in V3 has a purpose, driving motivation, and some disparate impact on the rest of the cast, to understand the intentions behind the ending, you must look at four of the arguably most influential characters in V3. Shuichi, Tsumugi, Kibo, and Kokichi.
西原修一です。一応超高校級の探偵ってことになってるけど。
Danganronpa likes to reference other media quite explicitly, and that includes its previous installments, spin-off games, anime specials, and so on and so forth. And of course, we've spent one of the previous installments with an ultimate detective. But some of the most interesting ultimates are the ones that are recycled, because that gives the writers a chance to invert some of the previous character aspects. This is the case with everyone's favorite Nagito, whose Zetsu boner has captured the hearts of many fangirls. The age of consent is 18, by the way. And Shuichi's an inversion of Kirigiri's character from the first game. In Trigger Happy Havoc, we're playing with someone who's always one step ahead of us, the player. A character is there, helping us through the thick and thin of it, and becomes a pretty decent waifu in the process. However, Makoto and Hinata are significantly more passive than Shuichi, who goes from a wimpy kid in the closet to one of the most forward-thinking characters by the end of the game, and it took a lot to get there. In 3-1, Shuichi loses his crush and inspiration, Kaede, because of a noble cause that does save everyone. He's given her inherited will to end the killing game. Kodaka has stated in interviews that this one trial took the longest to make in the entire series, and it's not hard to see why. Both the audience and Shuichi receive a gut punch that the culprit was who we never expected it to be. In 3-2 and 3-3, we see him become acclimated to the rest of the cast, and even begin to push back against the meek appearance that he was initially given. 3-4 is literally virtual insanity, a microcosm of V3, in which Shuichi is thinking drastically on how to change not only to solve the case, but also the mystery of the Hope's Peak Academy. These feelings are only exasperated in 3-5, in which he must come to terms with the conviction of his former mentor and friend, Kaito Mimoda. Up until this point, Sucky has been forced to expose his waifu, the leader of Japan, a folklore cunt, a gentle giant, and now the one person who has been with him the entire time. The pain begins to wear down on him. Then 3-6 begins with a retrial of 3-1 because of new evidence given. Maybe Kaede wasn't entirely to blame for squishing an avocado in the library. It's hard to fully express how much Shuichi has changed throughout this entire game in just one YouTube video like this, but I really haven't played a game recently in which the main character developed so much in front of my eyes, starting from the bottom and choosing to build himself up. All that buildup comes to a head during the trial, with the revelation that Tsumugi was in fact the killer from the first trial, and apparently Kaede died in vain. This breaks Shuichi on a fundamental level, but at this point in 3-6, we have at least 2.5 hours of trial remaining, so what more could happen? Well, to discuss that, I think we might need to cover the other characters first. And let's talk about the one who drives Shuichi to become a man who rejects both hope and despair.
Ah, my name is Shirogane Tsumugi. 超高校級のコスプレイヤーだよ。
Tsumugi is the ultimate life form, and I think it's highly relevant and intentional that she references Cars from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure as soon as you meet her. She represents something far more sinister than most people realize, or they do realize it, and that's why people dislike the ending. Either way, the ultimate cosplayer was chosen for a reason, other than to give a cheap nod to all the other characters from previous games returning. Fandoms are quite an interesting topic to discuss on the internet. Ghost Gum has a really good video breaking down the mentality behind them, so I'll have that linked in the description. Being someone tied close to the JoJo fandom, I've been through the thick and thin of elitism, memers, and the like, but the Danganronpa fandom is a whole nother level coming through your mind. Full disclosure, this is coming from the perspective of someone who has wanted to remain socially distanced from the Danganronpa fandom, never getting closer than poking them with a 39.5-foot pole. And, as I see with regard to a lot of other creators on this platform, and others outside the purview of this community, people enjoy Danganronpa but don't want to get into the fandom. And the character of Tsumugi is a direct representation of that situation. A rejection of fandom ideals, she is the personification of how Kodaka views the extreme members of the fandom, a cosplayer, a fanfiction writer, and proponent of ultimate real fiction. Kodaka is taking a clear podshot at fanfiction writers, as he has done with Hifumi in Danganronpa 1. However, the influence of V3's criticism for fanfiction writers might actually be more closely linked to the inspiration of the killing game genre than one might initially think. The Nevadatan incident was one in which a 13-year-old girl killed a classmate with a box cutter. Due to bullying online, Girl A, the culprit, premeditated a murder that was carried out during a school day. Delving into the girl's hobbies showed an obsession with the horror genre and, more intriguingly, Battle Royale. She was a huge fan of it and committed to creating fanfictions. When the girl's identity was accidentally doxed, 4chan took it upon themselves to dub the girl Nevadatan, coming from her consistent wearing of a Nevada University hoodie and the suffix tan being an honorific like chan, but for children. Because of Nevadatan's copious consumptions of more mature material, it's reasonable to conclude that some of this played a part in her decision. I am not making the case that those were the sole motivating factors of the actions taken. Oh, if you play violent video games, you're going to commit violent actions. No, I don't believe that. Clearly, her mental instabilities, developmental disorders, and tumultuous family life played a role in that. But a younger individual like her had no concept of what death truly meant, and it was a failure on the part of her parents not to address those obsessions in a healthy and productive manner. That was in Sasebo, Nagasaki Prefecture's second largest city, in 2004. It would be almost 10 years later in the same city that another horrific tragedy would hit. There was an incident in the summer of 2014 known as the Sasebo schoolgirl murder, in which a mentally unstable high school girl decapitated another classmate. She was later clinically ruled a psychopath and put in an institute where she remains today. Consider this happened in the 5-year gap between the release of Goodbye Despair in 2012 and the release of V3 in 2017. There is no evidence that this individual had any relation to the Danganronpa series, but it's not a stretch to think that these tragic situations might have brought into the limelight some of the influence for the direction of which Kodaka wanted to take the series. Unfortunately, I can't say the same thing for the Western Danganronpa fandom. Wow, if I had a nickel for every time a TikToker referenced Danganronpa before killing someone this year, I would have 2 nickels, which isn't a lot, but it's weird that it happened twice, right? Relatively recently, a TikToker cosplayer who frequently posted Danganronpa was charged with manslaughter, and one can make the argument that being on TikTok was more of an influence for the incident, but the jury's still out. Another girl who stabbed her wheelchair-bound sister to death also frequently referenced Danganronpa. I want to make it explicitly clear that if you're watching this video, you are not like these individuals. I would hope, but there is an easy solution. You don't let young children play games like these, especially in the age of TikTok, where teenagers are committing misdemeanors by stealing bathroom appliances just for the dopamine rush of internet clout. I waited until I was in college because I often forget how mature of a topic something like a killing game is. The Nevadatan incident was one of many cases showing that the malleability of a child's mind is something that should be handled with extreme care. And if young children are overexposed to media like this, it's very easy to see how children can become desensitized to it. And I'm not making that pearl-clutching argument that others would make. I understand there's a distinction between fiction and reality, but clearly these young girls, in all these cases, don't understand that fundamental distinction. And I think it's very telling that the people most vocal about their disapproval for V3's ending are having the toughest time grappling with the reality that it was all fiction. More on that in a little bit. But while Tsumugi can be seen as an allegorical representation of Danganronpa fans, her unique position in the story allows Kodaka to talk to the audience directly. The reveal that the humble, meek cosplay girl was really Junko Enoshima, the 53rd, was not surprising, but having taken on the persona of not only Junko, but all the other old characters in the series, provided a conduit between the audience and the writers. Right now, I've discussed the figurative conduit between the audience and the writers, but to continue on with the brilliance of 3-6, you need to discuss the literal one. Kibo is a robot. Beep boop. Danganronpa as a series has always loved the broadcasting of the killing game. This is a major motivating factor for the events of Danganronpa 3, the anime. V3, per the usual, ups the ante yet again by creating the ultimate surveillance state, in which Nanokumas are always watching. And the gimmick of Danganronpa's 53rd season is audience participation. What better way to exemplify that gimmick than by creating a character that can directly interact and shape the outcome of the events in the story? Audience participation is a key distinction between Danganronpa 2 and V3. One of the biggest criticisms of V3 is that it recycled 2's ending with the whole "nothing is real, it was all a simulation," which is a plot point in many forms of media, but ultimately draws its inspiration most notably from The Truman Show. But this goes even deeper than the second game because of one little hope robot. Being someone who tokidoki nihongo hanashimasu, I played the original Japanese version because, of course, had to, and the overuse of words like hanni, zetsubo, Kibo were everywhere. But even if my Nihongo Josu made me realize that Kibo is the ultimate hope robot, it's obvious yet subtle. It pays homage to how media can send us subliminal messages, leaning us towards one side or another. In Japanese, every time they say Kibo's name, they're saying hope. Kibo's dilemma lies in the over-reliance of his programming and dependence on what the audience wants to see. Kibo must choose between hope and despair, and by proxy, we, the audience, are making that same decision, until we don't, because for many of us, it gets way too meta at this point. And the game itself is directly mentioning that, which is like entering the 10th dimension of insanity. There is a more potent theme going on during the entirety of the game, and it's especially present at the climax of 3-6, the distinction between truth and lies. Kokichi is the embodiment of chaos, and I kinda love it. While playing, I absolutely hated this little punk because you never knew if what he was saying was true, and it just got overbearing at some points. And to some extent, despite loving to lie, hints of the truth can be found between the checkered patterns of Kokichi. White lies, one based with some tang of truth, and black lies, those that are explicit falsehoods generated to divert attention away from the truth. White lies are one that you might tell your parents. Oh, how did you do on your nuclear engineering exam? Oh, well, it was really tough. I think I got the average, so it's fine. Meanwhile, the average is 28%, but that's neither here nor there. Black lies are far more sinister and apparent. On the purpose of Kokichi, Kodaka stated that, looking back on the whole series, there was no one who purely enjoyed the class trial. Komaida, from Super Danganronpa 2 Goodbye Despair Academy, was a little close to that, but he was a bit different from enjoying. He was sexually pleasured by it. Kodaka didn't actually say that, but we all knew it. Oma Kokichi was born wanting to make the real trickster who enjoys a class trial like a game. Since lie was a theme for the game, I inserted some lines that were impossible to figure figure out whether they're lies or not. Kokichi knew too much. In every Danganronpa game, there's one wildcard character who you never really know where they're gonna line up, but you just kinda wanna wait and see what they're gonna do. Kokichi blows away both Byakuya and Nagito by being a direct foil to Shuichi. As mentioned before, the ultimate detective role is an important one for a murder mystery game, and he or she could be classified as the symbol of truth. That is their goal. And while Kokichi is in the search for the truth too, he goes about it in a completely different way. This is why the inclusion of the perjury mechanic is so important to V3. It opens up a new dynamic in which characters can discover the truth. This balance is hard to strike without feeling ham-fisted, but I think V3's use of comedy and fourth wall breaks allow it to incorporate these themes in meaningful and engaging ways. But lies are so important to understanding why V3 went the direction that it did, because Kodaka made a risky but rewarding choice to figuratively and literally nuke his characters and universe. Trial 36 reveals that Danganronpa is going to make the ultimate fourth wall break. Not just jump the shark, but take off in a plane, spelling out the intentions of the team with skywriting before falling back down, then educating the shark in philosophical reason for why the decisions were made. Danganronpa explicitly stating that it is fiction is a contentious topic because it's very understandable to see why people do not like that decision. If you've been playing these games back to back, you've spent nearly 80 hours on this experience, and to have it all seemingly end to tell you that your time was wasted could be repugnant. Kodaka's drive to take the series in a new direction was going to have backlash. Humans inherently are opposed to change. We like routine, schedules, and patterns. This clearly drove a divide between the fanbase at the time. And while I was not an avid player of Dang It Grandpa, I heard about huge fan uproars in the recesses of the internet. In an interview following the release of V3, Kodaka was pressed on the rift generated by the revelations of the game, stating, "Personally, I never tried to flatter the fans even once. That goes the same for this installment as well. Even if there are fans, everyone wants different things, and it's not realistic to accept all their opinions. Of course, if everyone says negative stuff, then that means we were wrong. But there were many people who said it was fun. Conversely, there never can be a game where everyone says it's fun. So I think we must think by ourselves when making the game." And this decision didn't negatively impact how the general populace regards the game today. Its critic and user scores were relatively close to each other at the time and maintain that same score even now. This indicates that it was still an enjoyable experience compared to terrible games that are endlessly praised by critics and reviled by the audience. And this shows that you can successfully subvert expectations from your audience without insulting their intelligence. Of course, being a murder mystery game, intelligence is key to solving the mysteries. So you never really can just turn your brain off. You need to realize everything that's going on, and this can be exceedingly difficult when you've crammed so much of this into just 4 hours of trial. However, as I mentioned earlier in the discussion about Tsumugi, fans of properties need to make a clear distinction between fiction and reality. Entertainment should primarily function as escapism, not the reality in which people live. And seeing how much more connected we became as an internet between the short span of the first and third game is reason enough to try and rope people back into reality. Visual novels are pretty apt at doing this, but it's not even just a confinement for visual novels and games, but all of fictional media and entertainment in general. The ending is so meta that on your first playthrough, you might not even realize what's going on due to information overload. Tsumugi is super evil. She wrote everything. The choices that were made were scripted. The relationships that were developed were planned and influenced by the audience. But it's telling because Kokichi isn't the only one who was lying during the events of V3. In the final trial, there are instances in which Tsumugi can be caught spreading fake news from earlier in the game. While you may not realize it because you're approximately 35 hours into the game at this point, it's really there. So how can not only the characters in-game, but you, the audience, trust Tsumugi as a reliable narrator? And then it becomes clear as day. No one is reliable. No one was ever reliable. Think about how compelling the motivations for each of the culprits were in V3 compared to all the other games. The one thing that's reliable is your feelings about the game. Your feelings whether positive or negative, are correct to you because you are the only reliable source in this fiction. And that's what makes the ending so profound to me. This is why Shuichi rejects both hope and despair. Let's bring it back to Danganronpa's primary inspiration, Battle Royale. Besides contrasting both the innocence of young students with the stupendous amounts of gore and violence, Chuya from Battle Royale and Shuichi from Danganronpa fulfill the same roles in their own stories. This even comes down to their names. Beyond the phonetical similarities, the kanji has a deeper meaning. Shu, the kanji for autumn or longing, and ya, the kanji for to be, in a classical sense, can come together meaning longing to be, where shu, the kanji for ending, and ichi, the kanji for one, come together to mean the ending one, the one who ends. Both Shuya and Shuichi long to be free from the killing games, but only Shuichi is the one who can end the cycle of violence once and for all. Look no further than Shuichi's reminder of Kaede and one of the strongest motifs in the entire game, the song Clair de Lune. In French, this means moonlight. However, what's more interesting is the original title of the piece, Promenade Sentimentale, which aptly means a sentimental walk. And I think that original title helps us explore more on why that song in particular was used. Besides being one of the most famous piano solo pieces in history, the song targets the emotions of the listener, as if you were the one going on a personal journey through the music. The piece has no definitive meaning beyond what the listener hears. The song is beautiful. The song is tragic. The song represents Shuichi's and Kodaka's sentimental walk at the same time. Bittersweet knowing the reality they created is at an end, but hopeful for a future tomorrow. It's fairly evident that Kodaka was signaling that he wants to move beyond Danganronpa and develop himself further as a creator. And there was significant backlash because people love what Danganronpa is. They love what he did originally and don't want him to change. They wanted to see more of the same. Now, speaking personally as a content creator who built my channel around a certain topic, I fully understand the urge to want to grow beyond your horizons in something different at the costs of alienating your original audience that made you what you were to begin with. It's a fine line to walk, and I think V3 did it better than any other piece of media I've seen. The epilogue of the trial makes it clear that even if the life the characters lived was fiction, if it meant something to them, then it was worth living. I'm not gonna forget these characters and experiences that I've had with them. The heartfelt, the tragic, the insightful, and the very extremely uncomfortable. And now both characters and Kodaka and the audience are all able to move on from this. That's the best way to end a series like this. This encapsulates the will and the desire to be free, the ultimate freedom. Freedom from the chains of being bound to the same type of content, doing the same thing over and over again. The freedom to explore the unexplored and do something different than anyone else in fiction. This is why the ending is far more poignant than the second game's reveal. At the end of the day, Danganronpa 2 fell into the sequel trap of being too similar to Danganronpa 1, with some extended features. Nothing makes that clearer than having Juko Enoshima be the antagonist again. As Kodaka stated, I wouldn't say getting approvals and disapprovals at the same time is a good thing, but that a strong game that I wanted to make despite risking that was New Danganronpa V3. So we had to decide to make it even if that means we would end up gaining mixed opinions. If we don't make this, we will never be able to make a different Danganronpa from 1 or 2. Danganronpa V3 was different. It took a risk, and the risk paid off. Other less talented directors, writers, and studios would have chosen to go the way the game explicitly critiques, making endless yearly releases of Danganronpa until you hit 53 different variants. V3 does not do that. It explicitly rejects the status quo. It encompasses the spirit of individual freedom and subverts expectations And I think it's telling that this decision didn't harm its popularity overall. With the release of Danganronpa S today, it seems like new life is being blown into the franchise. And while I personally would be fine if there was never another new main series Danganronpa game, I do understand there is a demand for more Danganronpa. And while I did say there is a portion of the fan base that I wasn't particularly drawn towards, I can't take away from the talented work of many amazing artists and creatives out there who have been inspired by this game. Actually, there's nothing I want to tell, nor there's some sort of moral, nor I want players to learn something. I just made it as entertainment, a fiction, ultimate real fiction. Danganronpa V3 Killing Harmony is a harmony between hope and despair, truth and lies, and fiction and reality. That is what Danganronpa V3 did right. That is why the ending is a brilliant virtual insanity. That is why I wanted to make this video, and I hope you all come to have some appreciation for the ending like I do. Wow, okay, that video was significantly longer than I expected it to be, but this has honestly been a few years in the making. The fact that I could still have this appreciation for the game that many years after finishing it is a testament to how well crafted it was, and I have massive appreciation for Kodaka and the entire team behind the game. As you know, I've been busy becoming the ultimate Duang and graduating from my master's degree this month, so there really hasn't been a lot of time to make videos, but I was so inspired to finish this one. And if you like this style of video, please let me know, because I want to drop these kinds of videos every once in a while. I hope you all have a beautiful Duang, and I'll see you all next time. Wait, did I seriously just go through an entire Danganronpa video and not mention Monokuma?
You noticed way too late! There's no Danganronpa without Monokuma!